Hello, art historians, and welcome to our first lecture, first and only lecture, excuse me, on late Gothic and proto-Renaissance art. So this is a really critical time in terms of European art, where we're going to start moving out of the Middle Ages and start taking those first teeny tiny baby steps towards the Renaissance, or the rebirth of Greek and Roman ideas that will obviously influence the art. So one of the major events that's going to lead to this happening, so context, okay, we're talking about a class that is art history. So the history we learn about and then watch the art show us how that history is happening. So in the late Gothic period, so we're talking like 1300s-ish, because the Renaissance really starts around 1400, 1450, we see the real impact coming from the Christian Europe interaction during the Crusades. And you can see on the map here the journey that people would take to go to the Holy Land through the Crusades. And as they went, they encountered through the Byzantine Empire and the Islamic world, and with their interactions with the Islamic world in Spain, that these places had kept up the study of those Greek and Roman philosophies and belief systems of humanism and individualism and science and rationalism and learning, and that these Arabic works had been, the people of the Arabic world had been taking these, you know, Greek and Roman texts and translating them into Arabic so that they could read and learn from them. And then they branched off of that knowledge and like advanced as a result of it. So during the Crusades, people become, because not all people going on the Crusades were soldiers. There were many, many people who went who were scholars or religious clerics, and they went and kind of saw the light that all these people had of learning and started bringing back those ideas from classical Greece and Rome into Europe, where they originally came from. And another part of this is, as they had been so cut off from trade during the Middle Ages and had been so isolated amongst themselves, they weren't really aware of this great big world of trade and goods like silk and spices that the Middle Eastern world had always had access to. So now we see a couple things happening. We see a taste for the finer things returning back to Europe, and we start to see this movement towards these Greek and Roman ideas starting to refurnish, and the art will reflect those belief systems. So this is what we looked at. This is what art would look at in the Byzantine Empire and in Europe, basically, during the Middle Ages. So remember, the whole idea is we're deliberately during the Middle Ages and post-classical Europe moving away from naturalism and realism because of that fear of idols. And basically, the church was dictating everything about art, and that includes in the Byzantine Empire. Like, within Christendom, in the Byzantine and Roman Empire, art was religious. That's all there is to it. And you can see here that this is not a physical location in this work of art. It's a heavenly location. It's very flat. It's not two-dimensional. It's not moving. It's not naturalistic at all. The whole idea was to teach a lesson, not to show off artistic talent. But then in the late Gothic period, so 1300s moving forward, we start to see those ideas coming back from the Crusades start to reveal themselves in the art and sculpture and architecture that is going to be in Europe at the time. So, for example, this is a sculpture from Notre Dame. And no, this was much, much later than the actual construction of the cathedral. And you can see here that it almost looks like a late classical Greek sculpture, like almost that Hermes feeding baby Dionysus, and, you know, the spear bearer and that contrapposto pose and that wet drapery look. And Jesus is starting to look a little bit more like a baby, and Mary is starting to look like a young woman, like she, you know, would have been whenever Jesus was born. So we're starting to see those ideas of individualism, rationality, like this is rational. This is how a woman would look. This is how their bodies look. This is how things would appear to be. We see those ideas starting to come back. And let's take another example. All right. On the left, you have medieval Europe. So you have post-classical Europe. And then on the right, you have late Gothic. And in fact, you can actually even see in the architecture that is in this painting where Jesus is being crucified, they basically put Jesus's crucifixion within a Gothic architectural scene. So we can start to see a little bit of change. And Jesus actually looks pained. The people in the scene look pained, as they would be. Like, this is a terrible thing that's happening. So we're seeing some humanism and the true nature of humanity showing back up. So one work of art that we have that really shows this transition is going to be the Rotgen Piata. And it looks like that because Jesus literally looks like he's rotting, all right? So a big change that you would have seen is, so, okay, in the catacombs that we looked at, the catacombs of Priscilla, you never saw crosses, right? Because that was a key giveaway that was Christian. And it was also a sign of defeat because Jesus has been defeated by the Romans. Once Christianity became legal and was the official religion of Rome, the cross no longer was a symbol of defeat. It was almost a symbol of victory over death and kind of like a symbolic victory over the Romans who had persecuted them, like they had achieved victory. Okay, so then during the Middle Ages, Christ would be shown, all right, early on, triumphant on the cross. Like, this didn't hurt, it wasn't bad, I'm over it, you know, it was not that big of a deal. But the Middle Ages was a rough time, right? And especially near the end of it, they got hit with the Crusades and the plague and all of these ideas about human emotion and the human soul and what it meant to be human, and not just that emphasis on God. We're coming back from the Middle Ages. And so now this idea that maybe it would be better to show Mary and Jesus as human and human suffering, that God understands our suffering and that, you know, it is normal for humans to suffer, and even Mary and Jesus suffered. So, you know, his sacrifice, like, it's kind of going back to that Hellenistic Greek idea of the seated boxer. Like, this is hard. Like, this is really, really tough, and it's more admirable because it's hard. So this Pieta right here that you're looking at, which shows the wound in Jesus's side, it shows the holes in his hands and the holes in his feet and how terrible his death was and how painful, and the blood running down his head from the crown of thorns. And then you've got Mary, who's definitely suffering and feeling that. This is much more human. Like, it's embracing, you know, the human struggle of it in a rational way, which is something that's coming back from Hellenistic Greece. So this was a big step forward for this idea of humanity and humanism and individualism and rationalism, which is basically the idea of doing things that make sense. So while this Pieta is not naturally showing, like, naturalistically, like, photorealistic quality of how it would look, it's obviously stylized, all right? It does realistically show the suffering of Mary. Like, she was never shown. She was kind of just above it. Like, oh, Jesus died, but it's okay because it's better for everybody. But now she's a mother who's lost her son, and Jesus is a human who suffered as well. And it's not so much worrying about his divinity and his triumph, but more that what he did was a bigger sacrifice because of how he faced it. And this kind of reflects what people could relate to, because all they were seeing before was images of, it's going to get better, it's going to get better. Hey, Jesus overcame it, it's going to be okay. But, like, that's not what I'm feeling. Like, we've had the Black Plague, we've had the Crusades, we've had all these wars, everything's miserable. I want to know that God gets that. And so this was, yes, Jesus suffered just like you are. So Mary and Jesus here are both shown in a, obviously not naturalistic, because this is not how people naturally look, but a much more realistic and humanistic way of suffering, and this is what it actually would have been like. And so this is another example. So according to how Mary had been shown before, she knew Jesus was going to die and therefore was very accepting of it. So earlier than this, she always looked like resigned to it. Like, yeah, I knew this was going to happen, I had time to prepare for it. But this is way different. Like, this is a mother who had lost a child, and they had suffered, and Jesus had suffered, and it made them relatable to mothers and people suffering, and therefore it made what they went through even more impactful. That, yes, they went through this terrible suffering, but in the end, it was worth it for everyone. So the person who's really going to be the bridge, the artist who truly is going to bridge that gap between late Gothic and the proto early Renaissance, like a prototype, remember, is like a first try. This is like the proto Renaissance, so like the early step into the Renaissance. And Giotto is actually from Florence, which is located in Italy. And Italy would have been the springboard of the Renaissance into Europe. And one of the reasons why is people returning from the Crusades would have been coming through Italy. That was kind of like the shipping points. Like, if you go on a cruise, you kind of leave from these different ports, like in the south. Italy was that for Europe because it had the closest access to the Holy Land and to the Byzantine Empire. So Florence, one of the things that they were famous for, Venice was kind of famous for shipping people to the Middle East, but Florence was very wealthy because they were bankers. So they could afford to give people loans to go to the Crusades or start businesses, because feudalism hadn't really grabbed on in Italy. Like, people in Italy were still having businesses, still making money, and therefore there were patrons there who could afford to pay for the finer things in art. And if they were learned, like learned or educated of what was coming back from the Crusades, they wanted to see the art and the architecture that reflected these new ideas that were coming back. So Giotto is actually considered to be a far better artist than even his master Cimabue, because his master, who taught him how to paint, was still using what was called the Greek or Byzantine style of painting, because basically it looked like Greek mosaics, all right? But Giotto started to say, we need to start painting from nature again and making things look how they naturally look. And he was called a great observer because he liked to paint from what he saw and what he experienced, and not just from an idea, but more based on how things naturally look and would be. So if you look here, on the left is Cimabue, his master, and then on the right is Giotto. So it's the same scene. You can see the one on the left is that Greek style, which kind of looks like a Byzantine icon. And you can see it's definitely got that look to it, because it's that dark, dark purple look to Mary, instead of like what we would see in Northern Europe, who didn't have that available. So it's definitely that Byzantine influence. But over here on the right with Giotto, you can see that there are depth to the people standing there. They're not just stacked on top of each other. Like, they're actually creating depth in the scene. People are not looking straight at you. Not everybody in the scene is looking at you. Naturally, if you were painting this scene, they'd naturally be looking at Mary and the baby Jesus. And baby actually looks like a baby. Mary actually has a body to her. She has the figure of a woman. You can see her knees through the drapery. Like, she's really starting to naturally look like you would see her look sitting there. So if you look at Giotto, right, we haven't seen anything like this since Rome, right? And we especially hadn't really seen it in painting, for sure. But what you're looking at here are, he's trying to paint from what he would naturally see. He's trying to create depth by putting things smaller that are far away. Things that are far away are lighter. He's trying to create like foreshortening, where this bird over here is kind of like coming forward. So it's bigger in the front and smaller in the back. The people that he's painting aren't just looking at you, like they're actually in a scene. Like, he's getting a snapshot of a scene and making trees look like they would look, and then showing what people would actually be doing. So this is a scene here of entombment, right? And what you can see here is naturalism at its finest. There's a natural dark sky, which is something you would not have seen during the Middle Ages. The church did not allow you to paint a nighttime sky because that was considered a time of evil. And he's like, no, nighttime happened, so I'm gonna paint at night with stars. The angels are doing different things. They're not all looking at you. Some of them are interacting with others. I believe this is the burial of the Virgin, I think this is the Virgin Mary being buried, but you can see people are weeping and lamenting, and they're not all looking at you. Like, there's people with their backs to the scene. Like, that's how a natural scene, like if you came across the scene, this is how it would naturally look. So you can see that he's using elements and principles deliberately to create this. We have line to create emphasis on the central figure. We have forms that can show like depth to this. Like, this was meant to show looking into a room, how it would naturally look. You can see shading, you can see shadowing, you can see a nighttime sky. Up here in the corner, you can see the shadow of the eve overlapping that part, like the eave of the roof. Like, he's trying to create depth and balance, and there's deliberate decisions being made to make this look naturalistic. So what does Giotto do that kind of steps him towards the rebirth of human? And remember, we don't say it's the rebirth of the art. Everybody thinks the Renaissance is the rebirth of the art. Yes, there is a rebirth of art, but there was art during the Middle Ages. Art is not being reborn. The ideas of Greece and Rome and their belief systems are being reborn. And we can see that in the art. And the Greeks and the Romans believed that humans were important. That's why they had governments based on the people that they made the laws, they had those ideas, they had institutions and art that showed people in their full figure in the round. Now we're starting to see that again. So when we're talking about naturalism, we are seeing a great deal of natural appearance. So like, this is how a scene like this would naturally look in terms of depth and atmospheric perspective, where things in the background are lighter and they're darker towards the front. They wouldn't be hazy. The natural scene, there's natural emotion. Like, it's how, it's not perfect yet. It's definitely not photo quality, but he's moving in that direction. Every human is unique. People aren't just copied and pasted like we would see in different mosaics and in Byzantine cultures. There's these techniques of foreshortening where you can make it look like something is coming towards you in the painting by making it look smaller, farther away, and bigger, closer to you. There's shading to make things look 3D. The color plays a role in the mood. Like, everything about this is naturalistic, moving in that direction. So the greatest resource we have for Giotto's works of art, we can find in what's called the Scrovegni Chapel. All right, and this is the Scrovegni Chapel right here. And you can see that it's very simple on the outside. And it was actually also called the Arena Chapel because it was built over where a Roman arena used to stand. So it's the Scrovegni Chapel because it was paid for by Enrico Scrovegni. And it was built over this old Roman arena. So kind of showing again that idea of location is everything. So basically Christianity conquering the Roman practices. Okay. So Enrico Scrovegni, his father, had done some really bad things with money that he wasn't supposed to. And in Florence, being that they are, you know, big into banking, that's a really bad thing. All right. So his father had done some really bad things with money, like cheating people out of money and charging excess interest on a loan. And Enrico Scrovegni was absolutely terrified that because his father had done those things, he was going to suffer the sins of his father. So to kind of make up for that and for his father's greediness, he has a chapel built to show off his wealth and also the fact that he could afford to pay Giotto to paint these scenes on the inside. So it's a little bit ironic that he's getting this chapel to, you know, make up for the money sins of his father, but he's spending a great deal of money at the same time to show off his wealth to build this chapel. But okay, all right, so it's kind of that idea of just like when patrons would help pay for a mosque, that they were kind of, you know, contributing to a place in heaven. This was kind of the same idea. All right, so let's take a look at this.
Thank you.
Okay, so the Scrivini Chapel is actually the work for the 250, and then the frescoes inside of it by Giotto. All right. And again, all of these scenes, and he said it's right, you can read it like a picture book. It details scenes from the life of Jesus and his parents. So Mary's birth, the birth of the Virgin, is actually commonly included. And even though it doesn't have stained glass in it, the walls are painted to kind of have that appearance of the stained glass. And you can even see like the ceiling is done in that beautiful blue. And then just like with the Romanesque tympanums, we would see that over the door is the Last Judgment. So you would see that as while you were leaving, because you may not see it while entering, you want to be sure you see it while you're leaving as a reminder of don't do the things that my dad did, because a lot of the scenes in this have to do with sins with money. So like, for example, Jesus getting mad about the money changers in the temple, and Saul, Judas betraying Jesus for 30 pieces of silver. Like, it's all kind of to send a message to people. And then in the Last Judgment, all right, you can see here, they did feature this, that here's Enrico Scrivini showing himself on the side of the saved down here at the bottom on the right side. And he's giving and offering this church as a way to make up for the sins of his father. And during this time, Dante's Inferno was being written and was very popular, and this idea of the different circles of hell. And so you can see the people descending into these different levels of hell based on the things that they have done, because they're being damned, while the people down here at the bottom are being risen and saved to be judged. And then up above it, deliberately placed, would be the windows for like the light coming in. And you could recognize in this scene, sitting beside Jesus, you've got St. Peter, who is sitting there in his traditional blue and yellow. The angels, the archangels would be in here, all the major figures present at, you know, the Last Judgment. All right. And this is a little bit zoomed in scene of Enrico's dad in Dante's Inferno. So the story supposedly goes that Enrico's dad was put into Dante's Inferno, into one of the seven deadly sins dealing with greed, because that's the sins that he was guilty of. Just to zoom in a little bit, you can see just how horrible these images were, right, for those that were damned. And the people suffering, like different punishments depending on what their crime was, and, you know, or their sins and what they're going to suffer. I mean, it's very vividly detailed and very naturalistically done. Like the nudity, there had not been nudity since Greece and Rome, but now, like, that was part of this. And not only this damned are nude, but the saved as well, right? So what we are starting to see this the return of is not just realism and realistic scenes, but also that idea of naturalism, right? This natural appearance of how things would actually appear to be. So for example, showing that nighttime sky, that's a natural thing that happens, but you wouldn't have seen that during the Middle Ages. And he's definitely typical of his time though, because he's putting past scenes into a modern setting so that people who weren't obviously there and can't picture it can relate to it and kind of put themselves into that. So you can see like the architecture here is definitely more recent than it would have been from the time of Jesus and their lives. So this is one of the scenes, Jesus being kissed by Judas in the moment of betrayal. Judas being paid is right by the altar. So like the scene of Jesus right here, Judas, you can see the devil right there as he's getting the silver, the pieces of silver to betray Jesus. And that's right by the altar as a way to like teach that lesson. This is usurers, so people who charge interest, being hung in hell by their money bag. So like, this is really to kind of say that don't do bad things with your money. Jesus expelling the money changers from the temple. He's very angry, and Giotto shows that natural detail very well. And this is the piece from the 250 that they include, is the Lamentation. And they kind of talked about that in the video, but you've got the depth going into the background. You can see the mountains lighter in the background. You've got the scene has nothing to do with looking at us. It's a scene for us to observe and feel the natural emotion that's in it. Even all the angels are weeping and crying. And the only way we really know who is important is because of the halos around their head, which obviously would not naturally be there, but that's why we're not truly in the Renaissance yet. And you can kind of see here the scale and the depth of these on the walls of the Scrivini Chapel. All right. So again, I find it ironic that Scrivini was so worried about being like his father, and, you know, atoning for his father's sin, but he also showed off his massive wealth as a merchant, that I made money through honest work. I was a merchant. I sold stuff, and I'm going to show off my money because I earned it in an honest way. Yeah, but you're still showing it off. So, okay.